So the title of this week's episode, Everything is a Nail. I kind of want to explain it here. Just as the every warden, what was last week's episode? Every warden has a vault. Every warden blocks the something like that. What does the warden guard? Your passwords. Warden guards the vault. Talking about tools this week. Talking about tools and reports. And so I had to, you know, whenever tools come up, you always think of a hammer. And if you're holding a hammer, everything's a nail. I don't know what that has to do with tools and reports. I just think, you know, if your only tool is a hammer, then all you're going to want to hit is nails. So
yeah, you know, if you want to save a private key somewhere and all you have is Bitwarden, you're going to use Bitwarden to save that key as an attachment because you have that tool.
I think that is a personal anecdote from quite literally us because I did that. Anyway, jumping into Bitwarden tools, just high level overview. In the Bitwarden tools section, features such as how your password gets generated, importing data, exporting data, and pulling reports are available for, I said customizing your instance. This is not, you're not customizing your instance with this. You're just, these are tools. If you want to dive more into customizing the instance, I'd recommend checking out settings, which we will cover. We are definitely going to cover. But really just kicking it off here. And to be honest with you, I have not used the password generator from Bitwarden's web UI. So the page I have pulled up on the documentation here is quite literally a password manager. And this sounds crazy, but you can select, you know, password or passphrase. Okay, fine. With password, you can choose the length, the minimum numbers, the minimum special, you know, A to Z caps, A to Z minimum, A to Z lower, 0 to 9. Basically, you know, special characters, avoid ambiguous characters. Okay, that's just a password generator, right? But the one thing I found interesting, I don't know, do you use the passphrase?
I have once. You?
I am not a passphrase guy. I have more of just a password guy.
So the reason I use the passphrase is when I went to rekey my password on a lot of my machines. I think I was setting this mini one up at the time. I knew that I would be using one password for basically everything.
Do you use one password for all your machines?
I use the same password for both of my machines.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. And then that drops me into a session because it's also the disk encryption password.
Okay. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So my just like a Mac, right? My disk encryption password is my user password. Now,
sure.
In a Mac, those can actually be different if you don't sync them up, and that causes issues, as I found out in the past with a Mac. It wouldn't really cause an issue with Linux the way I have it set up, but you know, it is just nice to have it like that, so I don't have to remember more than that, right? I do have actually a different one to get into my Bitwarden instance, but for my machines, my passphrase is the same, and I did create a passphrase
over a password
I did create a passphrase from a generator.
Really?
And the worst part is
how many?
It's really cool. Like, it's cool and deep, meaningful phrase.
Okay.
And I'm just like, I can never share this with anybody.
You can remember it.
Exactly.
Is it Hunter 2? Exactly.
It is not.
Okay.
It doesn't even have any of those letters in it.
I figure we use...
actually, it probably does. I don't know.
I figure we get that out there covering passwords here while we can. I don't think it had been mentioned the past couple episodes. But, no, I walk through. Basically, I do not use this web UI. I always use the generator on the add-on on Firefox or wherever. Just,
ditto.
You know, create a new login. You know, usually it's just email included and generate password and boom, there it is. And now that I'm looking, I also use the one-time password there. But password generators out there, it's fine. It's, you know, you're not getting anything fancy with it. The one thing I will note is the history. Now, have you ever had to look back on that history for the password manager or for the password generator? On the generator, if you click the little it looks like a clock, it'll show show you all the passwords you've generated.
Huh.
And
that session or like ever?
I'm pretty sure it's that session. I haven't gone back and checked. Yeah, it shows recent history, which I thought was kind of weird, honestly, just having that feature there. I know everything's encrypted and safe, but it just, and you know, they're just,
at some point you have to account for people making dumb decisions,
right?
Because I do that all the time. I've lost Bitcoin due to a dumb decision. I literally had to email the guys and say, oh, have my Bitcoin because I lost my keys, so I hope you're happy.
Yeah,
you know,
that doesn't sound good at all.
Yeah, it wasn't. I was really frustrated about that. So I'm happy to see that Bitwarden, you know, does kind of take that into account.
Yeah, and then getting into importing data and exporting data. I don't know. Have you used these at all or ever had to use them?
Only the initial time I switched from KeePass to Bitwarden.
Okay, how about that? So really quick, if you don't know, importing data is just bringing in data, obviously. And then the way I really like how Bitwarden has this compared to other services, especially KeePass, the Bitwarden instance just says, it lists off all these services you can import from. So I did the same thing as you. I think it was actually KeePass XC or KeePass.
Which would be KeePass 2.
Yeah. And I imported it in. And the only problem I had was in KeePass 2, if I had notes or additional fields, they did not copy over, which I didn't realize. So you have to be mindful of when you're moving this stuff, or if you're moving it or importing it, you have to bring over some of those secure fields if you want them to cross over, because you can. There was the one time when I needed, you know, I don't know if it was recovery or there was basically, it wasn't two-factor, but it was, I needed the note or whatever that was attached with the password as well, and it wasn't there. And luckily, I had KeePass still, it's still around on my desktop. Now, it's not updated or anything, but I had to re-sign in and, you know, grab that old note that I needed. So, luckily, it wasn't an attachment for production keys, but nonetheless.
Well, and I like to see here that they also have Chrome and Firefox, because a lot of people do use a browser.
Totally.
Just as
a password manager.
Do you want to save this password?
Yes. Yeah.
Please. Thank you. And so that would be a way to bump your security up, you know, in order to take those out of the browser and put them into Bitwarden.
Yeah. And I have exported before for, I'll call it migrating, if you want to call it. But basically, instead of, I have a self-hosted instance or an instance here, and instead of using a container, a volume, like a normal person would, right? I just let the container run. I had to export all the data out, and then I spun up the new instance. I did use a volume the second time, and then I had to re-import all the JSON data again, and no issues at all with it. But I thought you'd like that little personal anecdote on bad Docker form right there.
The personal anecdote is that you should be using an R-Compose instance, hands down.
I totally should.
We manage that.
Yeah.
We manage that. Now, also, I will tell you, I've never exported data. I think you asked earlier, but I have actually gone in and ran a dump of the SQLite database to get all of the relevant information.
Okay. So what does that, isn't that encrypted? Did you unencrypt it? Or did you encrypt, just dump it in?
No. It's just all encrypted.
SQLite database file? Yeah.
Yeah. You just grab that database file. And honestly, that's what we're doing where we're migrating to. We're transferring the SQLite data. That's what's stored on the volume. That's
right.
What allows Bitwarden to do the thing that it does. And so I was able to run a dump on it, and sure enough, everything's encrypted.
Right.
So it wasn't much help, but I was still able to get in and take a look at it. That was when I was trying to reverse engineer some of the API stuff. But yeah, I mean, it's there are plenty of ways to export or even just, you know, save your vault in, or, you know, in the event of a crash or whatever. Yeah. I mean, this is,
it's there.
It's not rocket science what they're doing here. It's basic crypto primitives and database primitives. And it just ends up being a really nice tool that can do fancy tricks like exporting your passwords as JSON.
Yeah. Now, going back to the exporting the data and having it all encrypted. Now, in the settings, I won't cover it too much here. I don't know if you could saw it. You can actually set where you, how many times you want to cycle the password for the cryptography. I found it interesting that was out there because I know you had mentioned, oh yeah, you know, you're cycling it 100,000 times or something, and it was 10,000 times, or you know, it was something like that. But I was digging through yesterday and I found that very interesting that you can kind of set how secure, how many passes you want to make on for the hash or for the data. Really all I have for the tools, there's nothing crazy going on here. That's what I'd say. It's password generation. It's importing data. It's exporting data. Now reports, I found very interesting. Reports, I link back to the upstream documentation. But essentially, reports are helpful for changing up passwords, cycling passwords, and updating anything that may be stale or exposed. You're going to want to change those if they're bad, honestly. If you're using weak passwords, if you're using exposed password, if you're reusing passwords, change them. Reports can be found right on the tool section. And I'm just going to jump over to the main documentation here. So exposed, kind of self-explanatory here. Exposed password report identifies passwords that have been uncovered in known data breaches that were released publicly or sold on the dark web by hackers. This report uses a trusted web service to search the first 5 digits of the hash of all your passwords in a database of known leaked passwords. I found this very interesting. I didn't know how they went about doing this. I knew they did not just send your password to a database and go, oh, hey, is this exposed? But their method I really liked, which was, if there's a little tip here, it says, why use the first 5 digits of password hashes? If the report, and this is their kind of response here, if the report was performed with your actual passwords, it doesn't matter if they were exposed or not. You'll be voluntarily leaking it to the service. The report's result may not mean your individual account has been compromised, rather that you are using a password that has been found in these databases, in the databases of exposed passwords. However, you should avoid using a leaked and non-unique password. Basically, it's taking your password, hashing the first 5 characters, and then checking the hash of the first 5 characters in this database to check if anything matches.
So it takes the hash and it looks for the first 5 digits of the hash. It doesn't take the first 5
digits
of your password. It takes the first five of the hash of your password.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
It doesn't take your password. It doesn't take your password and hash it. It takes the hash of your password. So I didn't know how they did that. I found that very interesting.
Yeah.
Obviously, next kind of reports here are the reuse password report. Nothing fancy going on with this one. Basically, it checks all the identifies all non-unique passwords in your vault. Again, just simple, I'd say, password security here. Don't reuse passwords.
Don't you reuse passwords? Just that's
don't do that. Why would you do
don't
that?
Don't do it.
Reusing the same password for multiple services can allow hackers to easily gain access to accounts. I mean, it's just bad practice, right? If you set the same password for every single service, it's not just your email you're going to have to change. It's everything.
Yep.
Next up is weak passwords. Usually these are just known words. You know, I assume they go through a database here. Yeah, here you go.
So it was interesting. I'm not sure if I had said this, but I was over here and I had to reset my stepdad's password on Nextcloud, and I just set it to change me.
Did it allow it?
It did not.
Nextcloud did not?
It did not. On Nextcloud, correct. It said that was one of the top
a hacked password
1,000 or 10,000 common passwords, and to change it. So I had to change it away from that. But this report here, what you're saying is, and that would give me a similar type of report if anyone I'm using, you know, ends up being Hunter 2, and I should be
doing
that.
It's coming across as stars to me, but no, and I'll tell you what, though. In Bitwarden, because you have that password generator, at least this has been my kind of experience, because the password generator is there and you don't have to think of some kind of random password, which, guess what, humans aren't good at doing, I haven't run into any issues. The report for me has come back clean on everything. So, kudos to me.
Well, I mean, I've been using password managers since I knew they were a thing. So, like, KeePass, yeah. And before that, I forget what I was using. But, you know, that to Bitwarden for the last good several years. And it's been working just fine. You know, I'm using it for all my passwords, so all of them are strong passwords. That's a side effect.
I mean, it's just good practice, honestly. Yeah. End of the day.
Yeah.
This next one I did find different is what I'll say. Basically, it goes through and the unsecured websites report identifies login items that are unsecured, HTTP, schemes and URIs. It's much safer to use HTTPS. We both know this. Now, granted, mentioned in an earlier podcast episode, just because it's HTTPS does not mean it's actually your bank, right? It could still be a fake website, but it's much safer to use HTTPS to encrypt communications with TLS and SSL. The report just comes back and shows you a list of these URIs, and then basically you should go through and update them from HTTP to HTTPS. So the next one, inactive two-factor authentication, basically. I didn't understand this one, honestly. This one was, it identified items with two-factor authentication is available from the service. You don't have a stored TOTP authenticator key. So it sounded like the report from this one was going through finding websites that offer two-factor authentication and saying, hey, you can use this to set up two-factor is the way I understood it, which, again, up until actually a couple of weeks ago, I was using my phone as two-factor, but you know, every time I ran this report, I don't know if it was the links were broken or what was going on, but I wasn't seeing instructions on setting up for, you know, it looks like in this one they have GitHub identified as one that you can set up for two-factor. So I want to explore that one, I guess, more. I don't know, it might be something to check out, but even on this most recent report, it didn't return anything for me. Now, maybe I have something just misconfigured in my Bitwarden instance.
Is it a local instance of Bitwarden?
No. Uh-uh.
Okay.
It's online. Okay. And then the data breach report here, you do need keys for the Have I Been Pwned database to check whether, you know, any of your information, you know, email addresses, passwords, credit cards, date of birth, any of that information has been leaked. We can help you set up keys for this. We don't offer a key for all of our customers, but if it's something you're interested, we'd be happy to help you out with it. Happy to help you get it set up. Now, I did run the report yesterday on myself. For all of these, it actually just runs the way I kind of understood it. I ran all five, but it looks like it runs one, and then based off the one, it checks all of them. So it runs one, and then it'll show green for all of them, and then it shows a nice little good news. No items in your vault have passwords that have been exposed and no data breaches. So, you know, you get a nice little pop-up for each report, essentially. But that's all I had for tools and reports. I would highly recommend to anyone just to check it out. You know, it's worth cycling through updating passwords, and it's just good security practice. It's just good practice in general. It doesn't even have to be security practice. I know a lot of people out there do use 1Password for everything. I'm sitting here, I'm going to tell you that's a terrible thing to do. That's just not the way to go. But do you have anything you'd like to add for Bitwarden tools and reports? Check out the integration video Andrew has out there Sounds like he covers some
dropped yesterday
tools. Yeah.
Still got that new video smell. All right. To be fair, I hadn't gone through those, except maybe the password generator and importing the data once, but good to know about those reports, and interested to see if I know my password will be strong, but you know, I don't know what I don't know, so I don't know if something has been compromised.
Right.
Right? This is the way that I would be finding out. If that's it.